Pantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Frenzied Rebirth by Matthew Peed. Narrated by Chloe Cannon. Chapter 1. Dungeons and Goddess. Azaria. It was a normal morning by the standards of most people. Well, actually, that wasn't true. What made it different was that it was the first time my parents allowed me to leave the estate without an escort. I'd taken all the normal precautions that we could think about. I wore clothes that I normally wouldn't be caught dead in, and had a wig, sunglasses, and even a hat. No one could recognize me. I never thought it would lead to something like this.
Now boarding. Now boarding. Please enter calmly and orderly.
The PA system announced, causing me to jump. This was the first time I'd ever ridden the subway. It might not be a big deal for some people, but for me, it was quite the adventure. I walked over to the ticket booth and bought a ticket for uptown. I didn't have any business there or anything. I just wanted to wander the city a little bit. I'd lived in this city my whole life, but had never gotten the chance to do so. Plus, I knew my parents had something planned for my birthday up there, though they were trying to keep it a surprise. I moved over to the crowd of people gathering for the train. Their diversity just blew me away. A lady who looked like she was wearing over $10,000 in jewelry stood next to a man who could have just crawled out of the sewer. I joined the outer edges of the crowd.
Why do I have to do this? There are other people. Damned for Leza,
muttered a tall, handsome man to himself next to me. He was easily a head taller than me, and I was already 6 feet tall. He had a well-chiseled jawline, and his eyes resembled an abyss. I had to quickly look away, feeling I was going to drown in them. The man kept muttering, but I did my best to ignore him. I wasn't going to let someone ruin my day out. The train arrived, and the crowd moved as one to get on the vehicle. I could have taken a seat, but wanted to experience the train moving, like in the movies. The train jerked as it started moving, then stopped almost as quickly. I looked around to see what was going on and caught sight of the tall man from earlier, who was glowing a yellow, unearthly color. In the same glance, I noticed that everyone had gone completely still. If I couldn't see some of them breathing, I would have thought time had stopped.
Ferio asun avios,
said the man as the glow grew brighter. I had no idea what language it was, and my parents had versed me on quite a few. I felt my muscles lock up. Under me, an intricate etching of some sort began to form, containing symbols I'd never seen before, and it glowed with a power that even I could feel. Yellow chains started to wrap around my legs. I would have panicked if I could have moved. The man shook his head, but the harsh expression on his face didn't change.
A pity, I'm sure. You only have yourself to blame. Your luck and fate were higher than 100 million people combined. Sadly, this led to us noticing you. Don't worry. Everything will be explained later.
I couldn't move my mouth to even attempt to talk. The chains wrapped around my neck and arms, fully binding me. It didn't stop the tears from flowing. I could only think I was about to die or meet a fate worse than death. I cried out over and over in my head for my parents.
Cor feri irf.
With his voice reaching what seemed to be a peak, a wave of energy shot from me into the surroundings. Everyone who was standing turned and walked toward me. I could only stare, as the man who looked like he'd crawled out of a sewer touched my shoulder and burst into flames. The fancy woman was next, followed by nearly 100 people on the train. With each flame, I could feel a force rising in my chest. Soon it was just me and the tall man left on the train. I prayed that it was over, then noticed the man finishing another chant. What more could he do? Before I could find out, the train jerked again. Maybe whatever magic he used on it was wearing off, but my stiff body started to fall forward. My head smacked his chest, and just like the others on the train, he burst into flames. I blinked as the world faded to darkness.
I can't believe a perfectly good dungeon has been sitting here wasting away. If I find Wes, I'm going to kill him.
Hello? I tried to say, but nothing came out. I tried to open my eyes, but still, nothing happened.
Azaria, are you finally awake?
Asked the voice. It was cold, making it sound like this was all my fault. I tried to reply again, to no effect.
Look inside yourself. You should sense a ball of power there. Try to push it out.
I did as I was told, and looked to the center of the darkness. At first, I floundered around like a fish out of water, but I eventually found the spot the voice was talking about. It pulsed, reminding me of a heartbeat. I pushed and felt the darkness around me lift considerably. When I paused, I found I was in what looked like a ruined tunnel, a burned-out husk of metal and glass were at the center of the tunnel. With a stab of pain, the memories of what had just happened flooded back to me. Was I dead? Surely if I could feel pain, then that wasn't the case. I expanded the field more, and suddenly a woman glowing a brilliant yellow appeared in my vision.
Ah, finally. You know it is rude to make a goddess wait 5 days,
said the woman with a glare in my direction.
What's going on?
I tried to scream. I was, however, still voiceless. She looked something over with a critical eye and nodded.
Good. It appears you're mostly there. I am the goddess, Terleza. You have been chosen by us to become a dungeon. Why and how is none of your concern. The earth you once knew is no more.
She paused as if mulling something over.
That's not actually true. Your planet is remarkably steadfast in sticking to what they've created. As a result, our projections have had to be corrected.
The whole time the woman monologued, I was screaming in my head. If I'd had a physical form, I would have rushed her and tried to strangle her. Sadly, I just had my ghost-like outline that couldn't touch a thing. This was unfair. Why did I have to put up with this? The woman looked at her wrist and nodded.
It has officially been a year since the beginning of the change. You're behind your siblings. Hopefully you don't end up destroyed too quickly.
She took a deep breath and rubbed the back of her head, then waved her hand. A burst of light flooded into my perception center.
That should help you get started. And as an added bonus, I'll allow you to bring one item from your past here.
With that, she vanished in a burst of light. I was left alone in the ruined subway tunnel with only my thoughts. Needless to say, I silently screamed into the stillness for a good while. I eventually screamed myself out. Whether it took just a few minutes or a day, I personally had no way of knowing. I knew if I had a physical body, I likely would have been huddled in a corner crying my eyes out. When I finally calmed down, I took a good look around. The first thing that caught my eye was a clock in the corner of my vision. 27 days, 23 hours, 45 minutes. I blinked as I thought about what that countdown could possibly mean. Probably something else equally as mortifying as what I was currently dealing with. I decided to ignore it for now. The tunnel barely changed, no matter how many times I looked at it. I couldn't be sure, but I felt I could see a good 60 feet in each direction. I barely had a car and half the old train in my field of vision. With nothing else to do, I started pushing my field out more. It appeared to be the only thing I could currently do. If so, this life was going to get boring, fast. I noticed a green glow and saw a few rats on the tunnel floor, as well as some mold where a trickle of water came in. I filed that away for now. When my field reached about 200 feet, I hit a roadblock. The field stopped expanding. No matter how hard I tried, it wouldn't budge. I just wanted to curl up in a corner and cry. None of this madness made sense. I stared for a while at the darkness. While I could see everything, I knew that there was no light. I wasn't sure how long I just gazed at nothing. Actually, that was a lie. The clock in the corner of my eye told me exactly how long it had been. 2 days. 2 days of doing absolutely nothing. I wish there was a setting button to remove this stupid thing, I screamed in my head, while thinking about the options button from my cell phone. The clock suddenly expanded, and a block of text appeared in front of me. Azaria Hylock, level 1, race, dungeon, type, undefined, ether, 20,000, floors, 2 of 1, skills, creation, deconstruction, summon, 0 of 101, teleport matrix, 1 of 1, achievements, god killer, killed a god, albeit a weak one, pending, item selection. I stared at the information for several minutes. Even I'd played enough games to understand the basics. The thing that scared me was the god killer achievement. The only god I'd ever met was Terleza from a few days ago. Wait, that might not be true. I supposed I'd inadvertently killed the man who'd caused me to be in this situation. He could have been a god. Huh. Served him right, I mentally mumbled to myself. I decided to ignore it for now. It didn't look like it would help me at the moment. Likely if Teleza found out, she would kill me all over again. That was one problem I preferred not to have to deal with. I focused on the last thing in the list. Teleza had said I could bring one thing from my past here. I doubted she'd let me bring my body back. I also had no way of knowing anything about the world. From what she said, it was different yet the same. So a cell phone probably wouldn't help much. I guessed I would just bring something that had some sentimental value. I thought about all the things lying around my room. Since she'd said the past, I shouldn't have to worry whether whatever I chose still existed. That was, if my parents had had to get rid of my belongings after I'd disappeared. The thought soon had me crying my invisible tears again. I managed to pull myself together about 30 minutes later. My parents were strong and smart individuals. They were likely still alive and thriving in whatever twisted world the Earth had become. Growing up, I'd had a massive collection of dolls, puppets, plushies, figurines, and other stuffed animals. I'd even started getting into models. My favorite was a life-sized unicorn my father had gotten me for my 10th birthday. I couldn't even count how many times I'd fallen asleep on it over the years. It would be perfect to bring me a little comfort in this messed-up hole I currently called home. I choose Starburst, my stuffed unicorn, I said in my mind, a cringeworthy name for a cringeworthy 10-year-old. On another note, I really hoped I'd become capable of speech in the future. I had liked to talk to people when I was a human, after all. A magic, circle-like thing formed in the middle of the tunnel, and the stuffed animal appeared, looking exactly as I remembered it. A large white horse with a silver mane and a rainbow horn that extended a good foot from the head. The moment it appeared, I flung myself onto it, but instead found that my perception flew right through it. Curse this non-physical form, I screamed, before devolving into another cry session. Chapter 2. Angry Unicorns. Azaria. I managed to collect myself in a record 5 minutes this time. While I couldn't touch Starburst, he did offer me some emotional support by being in my sight. I mentally cracked my knuckles and hardened my mind. I needed to get to work. on what exactly was still a gray area. I suppose I could try out these skills. I decided to use deconstruction first. There was plenty in the tunnel that I wouldn't mind getting rid of. On the edge of my field lay a pile of rocks, likely from some earthquake or similar event. Focusing on the top of the pile, I used the skill. I felt something leave me, and the rock turned to gray motes of light that flew over to what I considered my head at the centermost part of the tunnel. I could tell that the material entered a space of some kind. I could bring it back out if I needed to. I glanced at my list again, but nothing changed. I figured my ether, whatever that was, would have changed, considering I'd used an ability. That was how it usually worked in most games, but my ether didn't budge either way. I moved on to the creation skill. With nothing to go on, I took a shot in the dark and tried to make a cell phone. I pictured the one I had. When nothing happened for several minutes, I knew it was useless. I thought about what I might have to do if this was a game, but came up with a blank. My gaming experience was mobile games, after all. That just leaves summon. I concentrated on the skill, with the intent to use it. A flood of information suddenly hit my head. It took a moment for me to understand what I was seeing. Animals, goblins, kobolds, ghosts, ghouls, sprites, trolls, gnolls, imps, ogres. The list went on, but the options were all crossed out. I began to worry that I wouldn't be able to summon anything. Then I found one that was still glowing. Doll. I glanced over to Starburst. Maybe when I summoned him, it had counted against whatever system this thing uses. If it is on the list, that means it's just as good as the others, right? I chose the doll option, and another list of options appeared. I could design quite a bit of the summoned doll. The more I looked at it, the more confused I grew. After staring at it for 3 hours, I found an option that let me designate a target. I looked over to Starburst. It would be lovely to see him actually alive. I went with that and clicked the finish button. A stream of light flowed from my center and made its way into the stuffed animal. It took a good 10 minutes, which I hoped was normal. The light show finally ended, and the doll started to twitch. He slowly got to his feet and looked like a real unicorn.
What the fuck?
Starburst shouted suddenly. He jerked his head around.
You've got to be kidding me.
I drew back from him, not expecting this kind of outburst. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I cried, even though I knew no one could hear it. Starburst jerked his head around and looked directly at me.
You,
he yelled, while beating the ground with a hoof. It made barely a sound.
What have you done to me?
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
Stop apologizing. Answer my question.
I'm sorry, I'm... Wait, you can hear me. I screamed and shot back toward him. I would have thrown my arms around him if I had any. Finally, someone I could talk to.
Yes, tell me what happened.
Starburst, you won't believe it. I left the house for the first time on my own and something crazy happened. Some tall man did something and I ended up as this floating consciousness. At least I got back at him. Some lady named Terleza showed up and told me basically nothing.
What happened to the tall man?
Starburst shouted, or rather, neighed. At that point, I noticed he was acting more like a horse as time went on. It had only been a few minutes, but he was starting to neigh and canter. Somehow, I managed to touch him, and he burst into flames.
Shit,
was all he said, before he collapsed on his side. Starburst? I guess dolls could pass out, too. This is so confusing. What does it mean by intelligence, exactly? Does it make them smarter or more cunning? Or is it both? I was mumbling to myself when I heard a noise from the side. Turning, I saw Starburst rousing.
Starburst!
Ugh, this has been a horrible day. I am seriously going to kill Terleza if I ever get the chance.
Starburst said as he stood up. I immediately pulled back, recognizing that tone.
You! What are you doing in Starburst?
I screamed at him.
Ah, don't scream, girl. I don't have hands to cover my ears anymore.
Answer my question!
I screamed even louder.
You put me in here. You used summon, right? That would have done it.
Why? I asked. Maybe I'd actually get answers to some of the questions I'd had since I'd awoken.
Because the summon skill uses the souls of the people you've absorbed to fuel it. While normally the summoned would be like a blank slate, my soul is a bit different.
You mean all those people from the train? I said. If I'd had a body, I'd likely have been throwing up right then.
Yep.
I retreated from him while I tried to control my emotions. That was so cruel. Who did these people think they were? Getting to decide life and death like that? For the first time since this happened to me, another emotion, one I'd rarely dealt with, started to emerge. Anger. I wanted to hit something.
Screw you! This is all your fault! How are you going to make it up to me?
I demanded. I could see my mental image of myself poking his chest. Him being a stuffed animal now didn't help. I could only see him as cute.
My old life is over. There is no going back. The gods have a saying. There's no fighting fate. I'll work for you and help you.
You better believe you're going to work for me. That's the least you can do to make up for this.
I yelled at him.
That being the case, continue to call me Starburst.
I would have whether you wanted me to or not.
All right, let's get started. How many days do you have left? If I was your first summoned, then it should be most of the month, right?
About that. I mentally rubbed the back of my head while moving away. I only have 17 days left.
17? What have you been doing all this time?
Starburst yelled while beating his hoof on the ground.
No matter. We'll do this hardcore.
Starburst had me absorb everything in the tunnel with deconstruction. He explained that people would be entering to claim loot and treasure, as well as the lifestones that were in my monsters. I would need to prepare things that would keep them coming back. If they want treasure, then surely I'll be safe? I asked while I took a break. It didn't cost anything to absorb stuff, just mental strength.
You can't see it personally, but you're actually a floating gem. You'll be worth a considerable amount of money to the people of your world. Besides, to them you're an evil creation that is sending monsters into their world. They'll be doing everything in their power to destroy you.
Certainly we can just explain, I said, then demonstrated by carving a message on the wall that basically said I was once a human.
Starburst gave a neighing laugh.
Lies, deceit, traps. While some of the cores are made up of humans, most are from other realms. In fact, even the ones that were human no longer care about their fellows. You are very special, and that my spell was interrupted before I finished. If I had, you'd be a raving killing machine already.
Why? Why are you guys doing this?
I asked, curling up in a ball at the hopelessness of it all.
Can't tell you.
Don't try to get out of it.
No, I literally can't tell you. My memories of such things were erased until I finished my mission.
Some god you are, I mumbled in annoyance. He laughed again.
Brought low by a little girl. Now I'm some fake horse thing.
I cleared the floor. What next?
I snapped at him. If he didn't know the answers, then I needed him to be useful in other ways. He might be telling me it was pointless to try to reach out to the humans, but I would try somehow. That being said, I didn't want to die.
What can you summon?
Dolls.
Okay, and what else?
Just dolls, I replied, turning away.
You're joking, right?
No, everything else is crossed out.
Son of a bitch.
Chapter 3. Just My Luck. Lance Terran. Station 62. 7 p.m. Don't be late.
I glanced at the message and groaned. That was over an hour away. Why didn't they ever consider where people live before assigning quests? Something you'd like to share with the rest of the class? I groaned for a whole new reason and glanced behind me. Professor Mord stood there with his hands folded behind his back, wearing his famous frown. I did my best to smile. Nope, I was just silencing it. I would much rather learn world history.
Is that so? What was I literally just talking about?
Indians?
Alice, what part of the world was I covering?
The Soviet Union, sir.
The gorilla rode down from me replied.
I'm glad at least one person is paying attention. Thanks to Mr. Terran here, everyone is to turn in a 3-page report on the Soviet Union. It must relate to what I covered in class today.
A very loud collective groan rang out from the 53 students. I only did a quick count, but I was sure over 40 of them were also glaring at me. I smiled awkwardly and waved to the class. My bad. I made a mental note to avoid being alone for a few days.
On that note, class dismissed.
I ran out of the lecture room in less than 10 seconds, preferring not to get cornered. I didn't make it much farther than the classroom over, though, when a wave of energy flung me against the wall. Damn ether-powered.
Lance! 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 I don't have time to waste on a stupid report. How are you going to make it up to me?
Kyle, I'm sorry. I don't have any money,
I said through gritted teeth. The energy only grew denser as it crushed me against the wall. It felt like my ribs were only moments away from breaking.
Huh, like I expected anything more from a broke-ass guy like you. Don't worry, I'll add it to your tab.
The energy holding me to the wall vanished, and I collapsed to the floor, coughing. Kyle turned to walk away, but not before throwing me a weird grin. I rubbed my chest and worried what this meant for my future.
How was class?
Fine, Mom. I'm totally popular, you know. I have, like, 3 girlfriends, I replied. My mother was in the hospital. Magic sickness. A new disease that came with the Aether Shift. Just over a year ago, the world had changed overnight. Places of transportation became entities known as dungeons. Airports, seaports, train stations, and subways all transformed. 90% of the people who were at one of those places died, or at least vanished. Their bodies never found at all. With the dungeons came magic. People gained the ability to use powers straight out of books, like Kyle. Telekinesis was a moderately common ability. The world fell into chaos for several months. Old grudges led to blood being spilled across the globe. Thankfully, a group of heroes rose up and led the world to a better place, though they are said to have unlimited power. Not sure how you're supposed to fight that. Magic sickness came from living near a dungeon that had grown too large. Its energy leaked out, and if humans took in too much of it, their organs started to break down. The only ones accepted to this were those who could level up.
I wish you'd bring a single girlfriend, my mom said, putting her cheek in her hand.
I laughed. I'll get right on that.
Ms. Terran, it's time for your medicine, called a nurse from the doorway.
I'll head home then. I'll visit again in a few days.
All right. Tell Sarah that Mommy sends her love.
I'll bring her with me next time, I said, hopping out of the chair.
I left the hospital and grabbed a bus to our suburb. It was the only form of transportation besides private vehicles that still worked. They attempted to build a new subway station, but it ended up collapsing to rubble, no matter how sturdy the construction. One of the new mysteries of the world. The bus stopped at the edge of my neighborhood. It wasn't an exaggeration to call it the slums. Thankfully, my family had lived there for over 2 generations, and the people were very warm to us, even if we did see the occasional drug deal. I waved to the old lady who lived in the house next to ours. When you couldn't afford security cameras, then nosy neighbors were the next best thing. I glanced at the 1-story, 3-bedroom house that looked 50 years old. Old sky blue paint peeled in places, while other spots had faded to white. All but one of the windows were boarded up from damage we couldn't afford to repair. It wasn't much, but it was home. "Sarah, I'm back," I called when I got inside.
"Yo, how is Mom?"
she replied from the living room. "Same as always. At least she's not getting worse. She sends her love," I replied, taking a seat in the recliner.
"Is that so?"
Sarah said, without taking her eyes off the television. Sarah was a shut-in. Getting her to leave the house was nearly as bad as pulling fingernails. Normally, this would make me incredibly worried when I went into the city, but she was one of the lucky few to have gained a gift right after the shift. Frankly, it was quite scary. She could stop the heart of anyone within 100 feet of her. "We should visit her together next time."
"Maybe."
I just sighed. Hopefully Sarah would improve if Mom came back. For that, I needed to gather more money. Magic items were the only way to cure her, after all. "I have a job tonight, so I'll be out late. Don't worry about breakfast for me tomorrow."
"Roger."
I shrugged and got up to head to my room to get ready. I was going to have to leave at nearly 5 to make it on time. It would be Saturday tomorrow, so the dungeons would be packed tonight. That meant the bus system would be crowded. "Finally," I said, with a quick glance at my phone. I made it with 5 minutes to spare. The buses were more crowded than I even expected. I opened the party app, something that was made when the dungeon diving business took off, and followed the GPS marker to the party I'd been assigned. "Well, well, well." I stopped dead in my tracks when I heard that voice. Looking up from my phone, I saw Kyle and his group waiting where the marker was indicating. "This is going to be very fun." "Evening, Kyle. Is there another party behind yours?" I asked, trying to look past them. "Nope. And if you cancel, I will demand the entire fee." He spun the short sword in his hand. "I would never cancel," I said with a forced smile. "Very good. It's 7. Let's go." I let them go ahead, then started following behind them. "Fuck," I whispered to myself. Once the entrance guard scanned my phone, I followed them into the subway station. As the darkness washed over us, I prayed that I would make it out alive. Surely even these guys wouldn't murder someone just over a 3-page essay. Station 62 was a lizard man dungeon. They possessed a large amount of strength, but weren't too bright. They could be fooled by rather simple tactics. That being said, Kyle and his goons appeared to want to brute force their way through. To be fair, they had no problem doing so. Kyle would use his telekinesis to choke a lizard man, while his buddies would either stab it to death or shoot arrows into it. "Make sure you get everything worth money," Kyle shouted at me. "Yes, sir," I replied with a straight face. I moved forward and started cutting the body apart with my knife. My job was a harvester. I knew all the parts of the monsters that were worth money and would collect them, while the others did the actual fighting. I had no other choice but to do this since I had no offensive abilities.
"I like that. You should respond to me like that all the time."
Kyle had his weird smile again. I kept quiet. I really didn't want to talk to him at all. The next few hours passed quickly. Kyle was getting stranger by the minute. His goons didn't appear too bothered by him, so I did my best to ignore him. We eventually made it to the boss floor. I could just barely make out the teleportation matrix on the other side of the room. A massive ground lizard that was at least 15 feet long blocked the path. Kyle and his gang quickly went to work. Personality aside, they knew their way around the battlefield. In less than 2 minutes, the lizard was downed. I moved over to the corpse and went to work. This boss was dangerous to work with, since its blood was poisonous even after death.
Hey, Lance, come service me, if you catch my drift,
Kyle called with a heavy laugh, surprising me. The entire group had been rather quiet since we'd begun the dungeon dive.
No, that will not be happening,
I replied without turning. Was he crazy?
I would recommend you don't argue with me,
Kyle said, his tone taking another twist.
I know your secret.
My body turned against my will, and I saw Kyle was breathing deeply, his hand outstretched as he used his power on me. I couldn't even react to his last statement.
Stop! I'll report you,
I shouted. The thought of going anywhere near him was causing my stomach to want to empty its contents.
Oh, don't worry. After we have our way with you, you won't be leaving the dungeon,
Kyle said with a chuckle. I felt like this wasn't the first time he'd done something like this. Just my fucking luck. I quickly glanced around to try to find a way out of this situation. My eyes landed on the teleport matrix. The only problem was Kyle already had a hold of my body with his ability. I remembered the vials of blood in my hand. It was going to be my only shot. I just hoped it worked. I was only a foot away from him. Just the sight made me want to throw up. I narrowed my eyes but waited. When I felt my head start to be pushed down, I reacted. Jerking my wrist, I sent the still uncorked vials flying at Kyle's crotch. Most of the liquid missed, but a good glob landed squarely on his family jewels. With a scream, his hold on my body vanished. Without a second thought, I bolted for the matrix. I was about 5 feet away when an arrow slammed into my shoulder. I grunted from the pain, but the adrenaline in my system allowed me to push it off for the most part. I stumbled onto the matrix, and with a gut-wrenching upward motion, I was suddenly back on the first floor, right next to the entrance. I ran. When I reached the surface, I saw no one was around. The guard who was supposed to watch the entrance was missing. I clicked my tongue. They must have bribed him so they could scan my phone and wouldn't have to explain my vanishing. Fucking sick bastards. I couldn't go home. They would look for me there. My sister would be safe. She was listed under a watch program by the government. If anything happened to her, they would know instantly. My mother was in the hospital. I wanted to believe she would be safe for a while there. If I remembered correctly, there was a subway station a bit farther from here that never became a dungeon. I should be safe there for a few hours. At least it would give me time to stop the bleeding in my shoulder. I gritted my teeth and took off at a run. I made sure to cut through several alleys and streets, moving as quickly as possible. When I finally made it to the entrance, I felt like I was about to collapse. Thankfully, the blood had clotted enough to stop leaving a trail several blocks ago. I would hopefully be in the clear from here. I stumbled down the subway entrance while taking deep breaths. When I reached the bottom, I pulled myself over to the rusted old train car that sat in the middle of the old tracks. Seeing it like that reminded me of the days before the shift. Crawling onto the dust-covered and moldy seat, I passed out.
Chapter 4. Summoning. Azaria.
Starburst! 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 I said,
While making circles around the grumpy unicorn, he'd been ignoring me for the last hour. I moved in close and whispered directly into his ear, "Starburst." He reared back and stomped his hooves.
"Damn it, girl. I'm trying to think."
I folded my arms, mental as they might be, and pouted. "You could have just said that."
"Dolls are difficult. They are never meant to be the main race in a dungeon."
"Then why won't it let me summon anything else?" I shouted, throwing my hands in the air. Again, mental as they might be.
"I don't know. For now, let us just work on getting you a semi-decent fighting force. If you die, I die. I'm not looking forward to that again."
I have been trying to use the summon thingy, but my eyes start spinning when I look at it. There was so much that you had to input. Some of it made sense, while other parts didn't.
"Well, you are designing a personality from the ground up. What else would you expect?"
"Pre-made options," I said, mentally putting my hand up like a student in class. Starburst just looked at the ground and took a really long, deep breath. He didn't say anything for several minutes.
"Just select random, then."
I turned to look at the list, and sure enough, there was a random option. Is that safe?
"What do you mean?"
"They're not going to try to attack me or anything like that?" I asked, tapping my fingers together.
"They won't. They can't exist without you."
"That's good to hear," I said, then tapped the summon button. A swirl of light sprang up near us. I felt the energy leave me again, much more this time than when I had fused Starburst with a soul. I was sure that if I had a physical body, my eyes would be wide open. It was sort of fascinating to see a new body forming right in front of me. A doll about the size of a child came into existence. She had long, straight, silver hair that fell down to the small of her back, with a small pair of devil wings poking through. She was wearing a Victorian dress with a lot of fabric, lacy, and frills, while she had an expressionless face made from a white material. I wasn't sure if it was a wood or plastic.
"Now, is it a winner or loser?"
Starburst muttered while looking the doll over.
"That's rude, talking about a lady like she isn't even here," said the doll as she unfolded a fan and held it in front of her mouth.
I could feel some sort of power radiating from it. I wished I could see her status like I could my own.
As soon as the thought formed, another list popped open.
N.A. Level 1. Race, sentient doll. Type, manipulator.
"Oh, hey, Starburst, what's a manipulator?"
I asked, as that was the only thing I really didn't follow.
"What? She's a manipulator? How'd you get so lucky on your first random?"
Starburst asked, tossing his head back and forth. I swore he acted more like a horse as the hours went by. I just hoped he didn't forget how to talk eventually. The doll chuckled and folded the fan in one swift motion.
"That's right. Bow before me, peasants."
I ignored her and repeated my question to Starburst. "A manipulator is a being that is able to control several lesser monsters without costing the dungeon souls. They are far weaker and frankly stupider. But if the manipulator gets skilled enough, they can become quite powerful."
"I'm glad to see my luck is bringing me good things for once," I said with a fist pump.
"Ah, I remember. You had a ridiculous luck and fate number."
"I'm glad to see that you understand my prowess."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.